step number 8, for those who have the Life Recovery Bible, we're on page 1225.
What page is that?
1225. The reading is going to be from Matthew 18, 23 to 35. And I just have to say, too, listen to Jay. Where'd Jay go? I'm glad that I'm not doing what I was doing when I was doing it, because they're really getting stricter. Like, I did some time for some things I shouldn't have been doing, but...
Amen.
So I'm just going to pray again. Lord, we're here today with open hands and open hearts, ready to depend on you to help guide us through this lesson on forgiveness. We come to you for guidance, strength, provision, and protection. Help us remember that we are your children and your representatives to the world. Help us live today in a way that brings honor to your holy name. Show us your ways, Lord. Teach us your paths. Guide us in truth. Your ways are perfect, Lord. Thank you for offering gentle grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
You know, it's funny looking back on things, because God, you know, in my life and the things that have happened, like, I know God has me where I need to be before I even know where I need to be. And this message on forgiveness is exactly what I needed to study and speak. It's on step 8, so this is the step really where we begin to grow up, I believe. You know, it's where we start taking responsibility for our actions. It's about making a list. That's what step 8 is. It's making a list and asking God to help us be willing to make the amends. We made the list when we did our 4-step, when we took our 4-step inventory, and Bob's been going over the steps every month, and I think me and you did that together, the 4-step, and we went over, you know, how the list is done. So we subject ourselves to drastic self-appraisal, and now we have to go get ready and go out and repair the damage that we caused. So I don't know about you, I caused a lot of damage.
Amen.
And I know a lot of you in here have heard me share about some things, and there was a lot of damage caused to me. I think the biggest step in forgiveness is forgiving those who don't give you an apology. So we, in step 8, we attempt to sweep away the remains that have accumulated out of our effort to live on self-will. If we don't have the willingness to do this, we pray until it comes. And that's what it's about, willing. Just be willing. If you're not willing, pray. It will come. Some of my amends that I have made that I swore I would never make, I made. It comes. Refusal to forgive will make it impossible for us to understand and experience the forgiveness of God for us. And to be free of addiction, we must be willing to go to any lengths. And that's growing up, putting them big girl pants on, and making amends. The 9th step is the amends process. And I have to say, don't just, you know, go running out and trying to make amends to all these people. You have to go with a sincere heart, you know, prayed up, and talk to somebody that can guide you in the proper way to make amends. It's not about being sorry. You know, you get the word amends. You have the word mend in it. And to mend means to modify or to change. You know, it's the living amends. It's about not doing what I always did, especially to my kids. You know, it's not doing it again. All right, I'm going to read something out of the workbook. Now, when I work with girls through the step process, I do use this workbook. It says, we have been in the midst of transforming our thinking, behaviors, and attitudes. Our pride and false self have been punctured to reveal the new skin of a humble, teachable spirit. And Bob just went over step 7. It's all about humility. That's the central theme for step 7. However, considering step 8 may activate our egos and defensiveness once more. Just imagining having to make amends to some of the painful relationships of the past can activate fear of the possible humiliation in store when we contact these people. It's in the past. It's over and done with. Nothing can be changed now, we will want to protest. Of course, we also want to point out to our sponsors or our trusted advisors that these are people who harmed us. When do they have to make amends, we cry. All these excuses are ways to resist forgiveness. We may fear that other people will perceive that we condone their behavior or that we are allowing others to take advantage of us. But if we are to achieve lasting recovery from addictive substances and behaviors, forgiveness is required. Step 8 requires the shattering of our pride once again. To develop the deeper humility that opens the way to forgiveness, God expects us to extend mercy to other people, just as God has extended mercy to us. Unless we transcend our own hurts and have mercy on others who have harmed us, we will remain in the prison of our addictions. Lasting recovery and serenity will continue to elude us. One more thing. Often, we make a list of people we have hurt. We leave off the person who has experienced more pain than anyone else, ourselves. And I know when I'm working with the girls, I tell them to put self on that 4-step. All right, so we're on page 1225 with step 8. So the passage for this study on forgiveness is a part of the teaching of Jesus in Matthew 18 on life in the church. The chapter begins, verse 1 to 9, with a discussion of who is the greatest in the kingdom, followed by the parable of the lost sheep, verse 10 to 14, which underscores the truth that in God's eyes, even one of the little ones has such immense value that the shepherd leaves the 99 sheep and goes after the one that has wandered off. This is followed by instructions to the church on how to deal with a brother who has sinned, verse 15 to 20. It is in this context that Peter asked how often he must forgive an offending brother, verse 21 to 22. In answer, Jesus tells the parable of the unmerciful servant, which is verse 23 to 34, followed by a final warning. I'm going to read this scripture. I'm going to start, the lesson says 23 to 35, but I'm going to start at 21. Okay. I got my glasses. Okay. So it's the parable of the unforgiving debtor. Verse 21, it says, "Then Peter came to him and asked, 'Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? 7 times? No, not 7 times, Jesus replied, but 70 times 7. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who decided to bring his accounts up to date with servants who had borrowed money from him. In the process, one of his debtors was brought in who owed him millions of dollars. He couldn't pay, so his master ordered that he be sold, along with his wife, his children, and everything he owned to pay the debt. So it's an impossible debt. He can't pay this. The man fell down before his master and begged him, 'Please be patient with me, and I will pay it all.' Then his master was filled with pity for him, and he released him and forgave his debt. But when the man left the king, he went to a fellow servant who owed him a few thousand dollars." So we go from millions that he owed to this guy that owes him thousands. Mm-hmm. "And he grabbed him by the throat and demanded instant payment. His fellow servant fell down before him and begged for a little more time. 'Be patient with me and I will pay it,' he pleaded. But his creditor wouldn't wait. He had the man arrested and put in prison until the debt could be paid in full. When some of the other servants saw this, they were very upset. They went to the king and told him everything that had happened. Then the king called in the man he had forgiven and said, 'You evil servant, I forgave you that tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you?' Then the angry king sent the man to prison to be tortured until he had paid his entire debt. That's what my heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and sisters from your heart." In the first paragraph in this lesson, it says, "Listing all the people we have harmed will probably trigger a natural defensiveness. With each name we write down, another mental list may begin to form. A list of the wrongs that have been done to us. How can we deal with the resentment we hold towards others so we can move towards making an amends? And I'm going to stop there for a minute and talk a little bit about step four inventory. I have the girls do the workbooks in the book, and then I give them some extra work on top of that, and the four steps broken down into five columns. And there's the who, the what, and the effects. So who am I resented up at, what they did to me, and the effects column. And you really need to pay attention to that effects column, because it's not the who or the what, it's what is affected in you. One of your basic instincts are affected, and that's what makes you react. Okay, and before I have them go on to the fourth column, which is, you know, my part, you know, the part you played and all that, I have them pray. They pray and they ask God to show them the same pity, patience, and tolerance they would grant a sick friend. Say, look at that person is sick, and you pray for each individual one before you move on to the fourth column. Because when you start taking a look at what you did and your part, you need to forget about what they did. And I can tell you, a lot of you in here have heard some of the things that I have been through. And my biggest thing was, there's no way I'm going to forgive my father for what he did to me. And there is no way that I'm going to forgive my kid's father for what he did for me. And there was no way I was going to forgive the people that raped me and beat me and left me for dead. There was no way. If you can't find a part that you played in, look at your expectations. Expectations are stepping stones to resentment. There's a difference between anger and resentment. We're going to get angry. You know, it's the flesh. The anger is going to come. But resentments are when we replay something over and over and over in our minds. And the more we replay it, the bigger it gets. And the harder it is to let go. Okay, so after I start praying for each individual, then I move on and I take a look at my part. And that's where that amends comes from, that fourth column. You know, so my reactions towards what they did to me, my ex. I'm not going to sit here now and start getting truthful about how I was, because I can talk about what other people did real easy. But the fact that I would take a Louisville Slugger and beat him with it, that's wrong. And for years, I didn't see that as wrong. That's wrong. My kid's father, it took me a while to make an amends to him, but I did. I made an amends to him, and in that, he turned around and made an amends to me. So now I'm married. He was married, and now they're separated, but he's got another child, so it's the kid's stepmom. But me, my husband, my ex, their stepmom, the half-sister, all my kids get together every holiday, every birthday. I'll have dinner, and everybody will come over to my house. Mm. And we can actually look at each other. I hug him. Hello, I hug him goodbye, and there's nothing there.
Right.
Because I took the steps to make an amends. Because that's really where the weight that holds you down, and I'm not talking to her. That's what weighs us down. Okay, second paragraph here. It says, Jesus told this story. A king decided to bring his accounts up to date with servants who had borrowed money from him. In the process, one of his debtors was brought in who owed him millions of dollars. We just read that. The man begged for forgiveness because he couldn't pay. The king was filled with pity for him, and he released him and forgave his debt. But when the man left the king, he went to a fellow servant who owed him a few thousand dollars, and he grabbed him by the throat and demanded instant payment. I see this a lot. I've done this a lot. And I'll make an amends, and I'll be forgiven, and I'll turn around and just be a total, I'm not going to say the word here, but you know what I'm talking about, just totally nasty to somebody who got me mad. You know, it's real easy to forget what we've been forgiven. We are forgiven so much. So much. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
My kids. forgave me for the things I've done to them. Mm. Because I, in turn, the man that I couldn't stand, my father, and who I swore I would never be like, I turned around and I was the same thing. And I put my hands on my kids. And I neglected my kids. And I didn't want to spend time with my kids, especially when, in my addiction. All I wanted to do. I didn't want any responsibilities. Selfish. Self-centered. It was always about me and what I needed and playing the victim and what everybody else did to me. And, you know, as we go further on into the 10th step, like, that keeps me taking a look at myself. And forgetting and forgiving. I'm going to say forgiving because you don't forget. You know, we have to show the same forgiveness that Jesus showed us.
Amen.
We have to show the same forgiveness that others showed us. That doesn't mean we forget. We can't erase the memories. It doesn't mean that what they did was right. It doesn't mean we become doormats and let people walk all over us. And it doesn't mean we have to go back to that same abuse. I can cut ties and not put myself in those positions that I put myself in the past. We have to forgive them. That's what keeps a lot of people out there. Not fully making the amends that you need to make and carrying around all that bondage, that hurt. Then the king called in the man he had forgiven and said, "You evil servant, I forgave you that tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant?" Then the angry king sent the man to prison to be tortured until he had paid his entire debt. And remember, it's like millions and millions and millions of dollars he owed. He can't pay it, so that's like eternal torture right there. Pay close attention to that. We have to forgive. That's what my Heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and sisters. Refusal to forgive will make it impossible for us to understand and experience the forgiveness of God for us. Jesus taught his disciples to pray, forgive us our trespasses, as we have also forgiven our trespassers. It's, you know, the things that were done to me in the past, it always comes. Memories, reminders, triggers, it always comes. But the pain from it, it's not there. The hurt from it, it's not there. Mm-hmm. You got to take the steps. And I know a lot of you out there are in different fellowships and stuff. You know, and those fellowships tell you to do the step work. This is big. This needs to be done. It's in the Bible. We need to make amends.
Amen.
Okay, so it's not just stuff that they're making up. Listen, look at what Jesus did on that cross. Do you really get the depth and weight and understanding of that? Because I did some awful, awful things. And I remember having a problem with forgiving myself. And I'm going to tell you something. I remember reading a book. It was called Choosing Forgiveness. And there was a line in that book saying, you know, well, do you think you're bigger than God? I'm like, not anymore. Back in the day, I might have thought I was, you know. Not today. Do you think you're bigger than God? No. He's already forgiven you. What's so special about yours? And that was when I really, really took a look at the meaning behind the cross and what Jesus did on the cross for us for that. I'm forgiven. And I have to turn around and show that same mercy on the people that have hurt me. And people still hurt me. They still hurt me. And I need to forgive them, even without an apology, whether I want to or not.
Mm.
You know? And keep my mouth quiet and not point my finger and say, well, you this and you that, and let it go. And let God work that out. God has worked a lot of things out in my life better than I ever could.
Hallelujah.
Ever could. God so loved the world that he gave his only son.
John chapter 3, verse 16.
Got it. Amen. He's always on point. Whoever believes in him shall not perish.
But have everlasting life.
There you go.
Amen.
Go ahead. One more.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life.
Thank you.
John chapter 3, verse 16.
Very good. So that's God demonstrating his love for us. And I know there's a lot of people in here that you know, they've heard the gospel. They believe the gospel. Backslide. There's a lot of people in here that have backslidden. What's going on with your heart? Do you have faith in Jesus? Have you given him your heart? And listen, and we talk about this because it's the way to heaven. But there's also power in that name while we're here. And I am where I'm at today with True Light and this ministry, and the fact that I'm standing up here doing this is not me. It's him. There's power in the Spirit of God. It can stop you from picking up and going back out. It can stop you from looking at your kids and wanting to choke them. And I say that because that was me. It stopped me from hating. It stopped me from the violence of the lifestyle. It stopped me from wanting to hurt people. And it stopped me from letting people hurt me. You can have access to that power. If you're struggling, tap into the power of Jesus. Some of my best prayers, I'm not a long-winded prayer. Like, so I hear some people pray, and I'm like, wow. That's, you know, they just give you the goosebumps and stuff. Some of my best prayers are me dropping on my knees, crying, saying, Lord, I need you now, because I can't do this. There's a lot going on with True Light, the house, my life. If I wasn't so focused, I would be out of my mind. I would be out of my mind. But I focus on him, and that's one thing I've always done, no matter what has been going. You're not going to be happy, joyous, and free every second of every day. That is delusion. Okay? Reality is life's hard.
That's right.
And then it gets easy. And then you get slammed again, and it's hard. And then it gets easy. And then you get angry. And if you let it, it goes to a resentment. So this stuff is like constant. Right? Our sobriety is contingent on our spiritual maintenance. Daily prayer. Daily asking the Lord for forgiveness, because the stuff that flies out of my mouth shouldn't fly out of a Christian's mouth. But when I'm angry, and I'm frustrated, and life seems to be bogging me down, I'm human. That's why. I want you to think about these questions before we pray. We can't earn salvation. We're saved by your grace when we have faith in Jesus. Do you have faith in Jesus? Are you truly forgiven of your sins? Do you believe that Christ died for your sins as well as mine? Have you asked for his forgiveness? Jesus knows and loves you. What matters to him is the attitude of your heart and your honesty. Have you given him your heart? Have you been backsliding? Repeat this prayer after me, and you don't have to do it loud. You can do it silently. Jesus knows your heart, so if you're feeling something in your heart tonight, reach out to him. He meets you wherever you're at. You don't have to be perfect for him to come to you. He will come to you where you're at. It says,
Dear God,
I know I'm a sinner,
and I ask for your forgiveness.
I believe
Jesus is your son.
I
I believe he died for my sins. And that you raised him to life. I want to trust him as my Savior. And follow him as Lord. Guide my life. And help me do your will. In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.